Masham is a market town in the Dales of North Yorkshire, England. The name derives from the Anglo-Saxon Massa's Ham, meaning the homestead belonging to Massa. The Romans had a presence here, but the first permanent settlers were Angles. Around 900 AD, the Vikings invaded the region, introducing sheep farming, something for which the town is well known today. Its huge marketplace became the site for annual sheep fairs. A plaque by the medieval Market Cross commemorates the first market charter granted in 1250, making Masham one of the oldest markets in the UK. The original sheep fairs were three-day events, with a sheep day, a cattle and horses day, and a fun fair on day three. Up to 80,000 sheep came in from upland farms in the north to be sold to lowland and southern farms. The fairs died out in 1914 due to World War I, after which the sheep sale day recommenced on a smaller scale as an auction. Masham Sheep Fair was revived in 1986, originally as a fundraising event to raise money for farms in Africa. In 2001, during foot and mouth, sheep were banned due to movement restrictions. Afterwards, new regulations made sales of sheep too complicated, so the event now includes demonstrations and displays with 140 sheep judging classes, and the fair, again, attracts farmers from all over the north to show off the best of their sheep. The annual two-day event is always held on the last weekend of September, attracting thousands of visitors from all over the world, many of whom come for a taste of the past and the values of days gone by. Each year, the fair raises thousands of pounds for local charities. At Masham Sheep Fair, local school children hold an annual pageant celebrating St. Blaise, Bishop and Martyr, and one of the 14 Holy Helpers. St. Blaise was Bishop of Sebaste in the province of Cappadocia in the 3rd century. He was captured by the local Roman governor and beaten, tortured, and beheaded for not renouncing Christianity. His torture took the form of carding, in which iron carding combs designed to prepare wool and other fibres for spinning were used to scrape, tear and flay the victim's flesh. Due to the nature of his martyrdom, St. Blaise was adopted as the patron saint of wool combers. St. Blaise, or Bishop Blaise as he was usually called, became popular in England from about the 7th century as the wool trade expanded. As early as 1222, the Synod of Oxford pronounced that St. George should be patron saint of England and that all wool combers should not work on February the 3rd, being St. Blaise's Day, an edict which was soon translated as meaning a holiday for every wool worker to take the day off. Legend has it that during his captivity he saved a boy who had a fishbone lodged in his throat, so he's also been adopted as the patron saint of throat ailments. Blaise is usually represented holding two cross candles in his hand, the blessing of St. Blasius against evils of the throat, or in a cave surrounded by wild beasts, as he was said to have been found when captured by the Roman governor. After the Industrial Revolution, when spinning and combing were mechanised, the cult of St. Blaise seemed to have all but died out in the south of England, in contrast to the weaving towns in the north, where huge processions were staged in his name.
Ho yay! Ho yay! Ho yay! To all good people gathered, it is my pleasing duty, as the official town crier for Mashamshire, to introduce to you today the chaplain to the Bishop Blaise, who will now read the declaration.
My friends, the day of Bishop Blaise is here, the joyfulest day in all the year, wherein all tradesmen rejoice and sing, from comber to the greatest king. When first the art of combing was found, by Blaise through England it did sound, and therefore canonised be he amongst saints to all eternity. Here's a health unto our masters now, and then drink health unto our king. What one invents, the other support, whilst Indians mourn and we true Brits support.
Give him a big hand, ladies and gentlemen. I did yesterday question the racist bit at the end, but I don't think it is actually, so that's fine. The Indians are supporting it. And well done you, it was excellently read. You did 2 days of that, this chap, did very well. And won't wait for Mummock, he wants to be out. Don't think it's very well controlled, Lady Masham. Anyway, there we go. Oh, Monarch doesn't like the drums, this one is though. All right.
before when he made his dog do all the work. They now have to form a partnership and a team and work together, because to get them up these obstacles, over and under and in, they have to there work together as a team. And there you are, look, you see. All our dogs that we have brought here with us today, they're all registered with the International Sheepdog Society. They're very well-bred working Border Collies. But when you buy them as pups, you cannot guarantee that these dogs are going to turn out like this one. It was a gamble that Philip took, but at 10 months old when he bought it, he could see something quite special in it. And Philip, being the age he is and the experience he's had, he could see that this dog was probably going to turn out well, and he worked and worked on her for the last 2 years, and this is the end result. And if there's any of you out there would like to have a word with Philip or myself after the demonstration, any questions you would like to ask about how we train them, what we generally do with them in our lives, please, please do feel free to come and have a word with us. It's quite rare that you get a Border Collie of this colour. The traditional colour is like Maisie over there, who's going crazy at the moment. She's 10 years old and she's acting like a pup. The traditional markings are a white neck, that white tip on the tail, and white legs. And so it's quite unusual that you get a dog of this colour. And many people will say that they don't actually like having, we call them red Border Collies, that they don't like red Border Collies on the farm because the sheep actually think that they are foxes and can be quite frightened of them. But our sheep have got used to this dog, and I'm sure you can understand why. She is just one amazing dog. Philip started running dogs when he was only 3 years old, and he has appeared on many, many television programmes, including Blue Peter, the Dales ITV, Calendar and Lucknow, the regional TV programmes, the radio programmes. He's been on Radio 4, Farming Today, and at 18 years old, the experience he has had with these dogs will surely stand him in good stead for the rest of his life. And there you are. I hope you've enjoyed his demonstration, ladies and gentlemen. Put your hands together and give him a big round of applause.
Right, so let's have a look what the sheep's produced. Okay, so here's our little fleece here, okay, not much of a fleece there. Now, of course, when we're shearing, we get paid per sheep, so we want to get on to the next sheep. We don't want to be sorting the wool out, okay, there's always someone to give us a hand. In New Zealand and Australia, we call those people a rousey. Over here, they're called an agricultural wool technician, yeah. Okay, so we're going to roll it up right now. Remember, wool has this other wonderful quality. It's very springy. It keeps bouncing back. Now, that's very useful when it comes to carpet making. Okay, because that spring will remain in your carpets for years and years. So folks, remember that when you're going to buy a carpet. So we gather up, then goes in the wool sack. It's then sent to our sorting houses. They sort through every fleece in the country. 34 million. Now have a look at the colour. What colour do we want the wool to be, kids? Well done. Mine out. Oh, look at there. You got a nice woolly jumper now. Okay, so we want it to be white. Okay, you wanted some freebies. There we go. Okay. And we have a look at the length. Now remember, that sheep had never been shorn before. So the first bit of wool it grew was when it was a baby lamb, had that little bit on the top there called the lamb's tip. All of that has grown in a year, okay? Most of it in the summertime, so there's last summer. Middle of the winter was where my fingers are, okay, in this summer so far. Okay, good length, test its strength. Ah, now what's happened there, a bit like us, if we get stressed, our hair falls out. Same with the sheep, okay? In the middle of the winter, very harsh winter up there, okay? And that sheep got probably looked after its body weight more than its wool, so we've got a weakness in the staple. We want one long, strong bit of wool. Anyway, they give us a price. Well, one of these fleeces will make about two or three jumpers worth, or equivalent. So how much do you reckon this fleece is worth? farmers be quiet. Okay, any ideas, madam?
10p.
Figures. £2? Yeah, okay. Well, that's a very Yorkshire answer there. Okay, right, okay. Considering in London the other day, I had £45, okay. I sold the whole lot, okay. But, nice visa checkbook, that one. Okay, but, this fleece here, okay, because it's got a bad break on this, it's probably worth about, probably about £1, if that, okay. Out of that pound, I've got to get paid, and I get paid over £1 for shearing the sheep. So this one, okay, we'll probably lose money on. Never mind, the old farmers, they keep struggling on. You're a sympathetic lot out there, aren't you? Cool. Right, never mind. Taken to Bradford, sold in the world market. Whoever buys it gets a scout wash. Now, kids, look. On the underside, it's nice and clean. But look on the top side. It's all as dirt. We don't want that dirt in our jumpers. No, so that's got to be washed out. It goes in a huge washing machine or a scourer, washes all the dirt out of it. It also takes out another wonderful product called lanolin. Now, lanolin, ladies and girls, is the base of a lot of face creams, hand creams, lipsticks. It comes from the fleece here. It gives you lovely soft hands. I mean, these hands are so soft, they really should belong in a woman. I love the English language. It's so versatile, isn't it? Okay, so let's extract that one then. Cobalt cardboard. Basically, simply the pipeline.
We wish you the very, very best of luck. I'm going to go down here. Just remind me of your name and how old you are.
Aaron Dawn, I'm 8.
8 years old, and I think we will...
9!
It's the excitement of it all. Well, you've turned your lamb out perfectly. You've made sure that she's been standing. I've been watching you. You've been making sure she's been standing right. So give him a big round of applause. Well done. There you are.
Looking this way
for me,
that's good, excellent.
So, second prize. Oh, don't look all longing at me like that. It's hard work, is this? I'm going to go down here. You've looked after that lamb brilliantly under very, very hard circumstances. Well done. Give me. Well done. Very well turned out. And definitely the third goes down here. Well done. Yeah. Well done.
fourth prize, I'm going to go here. Well done. Oh, I hate doing this because it makes me... I'm going to go down here to the fifth. I think, I really do think you are going to be a farmer in the future. I can see that. Very well turned out. Well done. Is this the last ticket? Oh, you've got some specials. Some specials. Any worse off than the rest. It's been a very, very hard decision to make, but do come back again next year. Keep showing your lambs and keep enjoying the sheep. They'll drive you crackers sometimes, but there'll be days when you have very, very happy days with them. Very rewarding days. He's just hoping he has enough now. Well done, very, very well turned out. You've got a rosette. Well done, young sir. You'll be a farmer in the future, I can see that, definitely. Yes? Well done. Keep helping your sister and come back next year, won't you? Yeah? No, you want to stick it here? Well done, you'll come back again next year, won't you? Try again, yeah? Very, very well done to all of you. Give them a big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. They were very, very worthy show today in these awful weather conditions. Right, I will hand you back to Mike now, and I'm going to have to dash across to the field behind the church.
Right, now, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, we're going to do, we normally do this at the end, but first of all, this is for the Young Hands Championship, and the under seven is Molly Doherty. So here's Molly. Molly did all good. Come on, Molly, you've never stopped smiling. This is Paul Theakston. He's the man that makes Black Sheep beer. He's a major sponsor of this show, so we're very grateful to you, and you've done really well, Molly, you know. And then the other guy, we've got Aaron Bell.
For our final appearance at Masham Sheep Fair, and really I'm here to promote the working Border Collie, a fine example there of a dog that does everything you could possibly want. She's now 10 years old, been through quite a rather large operation at the beginning of this week, and she's come back still wanting to work at the end of the day. Now, I know there's a lot of farmers out here that will own quad bikes. I mean, we ourselves did own a quad bike until it got pinched. But we always believe that there's still a place for the working Border Collie on your farm. I know a lot of you will gather your sheep in with your quad bikes, but the delight that these dogs bring working with them every day of our lives, they do tasks that there's no way you could complete these without these Border Collies. You can use a collie with your quad bike because a quad bike will take to areas, but you still have your dog running at the side of you. If you want to split a lamb and a sheep off from the rest of the flock, hard to do with a quad bike and hard to do it yourself if you don't move about so fast. But these dogs, if they're trained up to a standard, will do that for you. They will split a sheep and a lamb out of the flock quite easily if you ask them to. That dog there, years ago, used to actually catch lambs for me, in that I would direct her onto a lamb that I needed. It might have been short of milk, and although short of milk could still run like the clappers, but she would circle it, she would run round and round it, and then she would get her nose under the lamb's front legs, flick it up in the air, and believe it or not, as it came down, she would actually put a paw across the lamb, because she knew by then I was racing across the field, trying to catch after her and the lamb, and she would hold it without hurting it until I got to her. And that dog, I have been offered a lot of money for in the past, but I would never ever part with her, because money couldn't replace that dog. See here, I'm not even asking her to do anything. She doesn't even know where I am at the moment. She can hear me, but she's not a clue. Oh, she spotted me. She's not a clue where I am. But she will never, ever stop working. And that is why we must keep these border collies going. They've been bred for centuries for their herding abilities. And it worries me and it hurts me when I see animals like this that have gone into homes where they can't work. And I think we must always try and keep up to the things that this breed want to do. Now I'm going to see if Maisie will, by herself, manage to put those geese into the pen. It won't be easy. But she knows what her job is. She's looking at me. She's saying, come on, Mother, what next? So we'll just see if she can get them in there without my help.
Trust me, she won't. Now she'll go wildly excited and chase them out. Stop that! Well done, Carol. One thing Carol didn't say, she's too modest. Geese are a heck of a lot worse of moving sheep like this than sheep. I mean, sheep have just popped into an old bed.
That was just a taste of Masham Sheep Fair. Just some of the stories of a packed weekend of arts, crafts, folklore, legend and country life. It's an event that takes over the whole town, rain or shine. See you there next year. Thank you.
Marches, North Yorkshire Moors, the Pennines, the Cheviots, Scottish Highlands, all those vast areas, something like 60% of the country, have hill breeds on them, most of them horned. You've got rough fells over there at the moment, very typical of the breeds that run on the hills. These borays would be typical on the west coast of Scotland. For about 3 years, they run on the hill and they produce lambs to replace themselves. So that keeps the flock numbers going. When they get to